Our Cinemarathon continues, and there's a bonus code for a combat mission waiting for you at the end of the episode. Enjoy!
The inscription on the stone reads, "Here the platoon of machine gunners held the line June 20th, 1944. We only have this stone to trust. The sea never leaves a trace."
Those who don't feel danger die.
But deep below, at a depth of 54 meters, an image of a naval battle is frozen in time.
Rucksacks, grenades, and helmets. Pay attention to that.
We are the first people to see that battle. These are absolutely specific ship classes. That's why there is no chance of it being fiction.
And we're the first people to see the outcome of that battle.
We found the T-31 and...
Greetings, friends. This is Underwater Romance. We're on the tiny island of Neva in the Baltic Sea. It's just rocks and seagulls amidst the water. However, it was a highly important rock back in 1944. It was used as a departure point for the Soviet fleet, and German and Finnish sailors had to depart from this rock as well. Surprisingly, the Battle of Neva Island is largely unknown. The largest victory of the Baltic Fleet Surface Forces over the entire course of the Great Patriotic War was achieved here. We're going to show you the victories of our ships, and ships of our victory. On Neva Island now, you can find just a lighthouse tower, abandoned buildings erected after World War II, such as a boathouse facing the sea, everything faces the sea here, and numerous nests of the seagulls who rule over the island. It's just a small island, a rock amid the Gulf.
It's a rock, a granite rock that has risen from the soil.
Why was this rock so important in 1944?
We can see the Karelian Isthmus over there. Our units approached Vyborg, and the issue of landing our troops on the Biryozovye Islands came up. Finnish units that had retreated from the mainland were located there. So we needed to block the routes to prevent them from evacuating. This island is located on the route that ships take to get to the Finnish skerries. The decision was made to land troops here. It was a small landing unit. An artillery battery comprising three 45mm guns and a reinforced marine infantry company.
But there's no fortification, nothing. It's just a rock with three guns on it, right?
To prevent any possible enemy ship movements. In the evening on June 19th, there was a total fuss on our part. Two landing groups were coming here. The first group was coming here and included 17 of our ships. And the second, 14 ships, were covering the landing of several reconnaissance units on the Biryozovye Islands. The Germans considered it to be the start of landing troops. They used the code word Drosselfang, hunt for thrushes. It was an order. The word Drosselfang, spoken over the radio, was the order to destroy Russian landing forces.
The Vyborg Petrozavodsk Offensive, the fourth out of 10 strikes that Stalin had to make in order to render Vyborg safe. The Finnish weren't able to withstand the attack and called the Germans for help. The latter sent two torpedo boats to assist, T-30 and T-31. As you may have guessed, if an expedition of the Underwater Research Center within the Russian Geographical Society is currently working near Neva Island, something went wrong with the Germans. The object we're examining is T-31, lying at a depth of 54 meters. The torpedo boat has broken in half. The ship has been searched for 75 years. The coordinates indicated in the Soviet and German archives were incorrect.
It's very difficult to search for World War II-era ships. The error could be anything from a mile up to 10 or 12 miles. It creates specific problems from the point of view of conducting searches. Strangely enough, it's easier to look for ships from the 19th or 18th centuries. Our German colleagues, former officers of the German Democratic Republic Navy, who work in the archives, sent us a German report map of that battle. It showed the route the two destroyers took.
That was Operation Drosselfang?
Yes, yes. When we examined the information, we understood where the error might be.
In 2019, divers of the Underwater Research Center of the RGS worked on site and managed to find a ship sign plate. That's basically a ship's business card. It became clear that it was the T-31. It was the torpedo boat of the Project's 1939 that had been built on February 5, 1944, in the city of Elbing, at the F. Schichau shipyard, a German city that would later become part of Poland. That's what evil armed to the teeth looked like. This particular evil received factory number S1513. An Austrian Heinrich, Peter Perkum, who was more familiar with office routines than ships, was appointed as her captain, and she was sent to lay mines in the Gulf of Finland. The evil had only 5 more months to live.
A remotely operated underwater vehicle, in common terms, a robot. We provide a visual estimation of visibility for divers, or we can work together. The robot goes first, then the divers. Divers can use a strength power communications cable, or they can just go down without it and check the robot.
Robots don't work for people. They take risk in their place. But even after the remotely operated vehicle performs reconnaissance, divers still deal with serious dangers at the bottom. The Drosselfang raid was the first and last for the torpedo boat. The Germans carried not only a large amount of bottles, which mostly looked like beer bottles, but also a lot of ammunition. They hadn't planned on saving their ammunition, but they didn't manage to spend it all either.
Machine gun belts, very many magazines, some rounds for Oerlikon anti-air semi-automatic guns, and some rounds for 8.8cm guns. However, the ammunition has rusted badly. On one hand, we shouldn't touch them, but on the other hand, they are heavily corroded. Some grenades fell from boxes and are lying around. The best preserved part of it is perhaps its wooden handle.
The signal pistol is unique because the two-barreled model was only ever made for the Kriegsmarine.
They were found in the sediment at the bow end of the ship. Both of them were made for Kriegsmarine. The barrel is made of a non-ferrous metal which is not susceptible to corrosion. And these ones were even made of high-quality stainless steel by the Walther Company. One can see that it has been preserved well, even despite the water conditions of the Baltic Sea. 3,100 of such two-barreled signal pistols were produced before 1944.
It's very hard work. The attitude, "they were our foes, nobody invited them here," doesn't work. At such moments, some common human emotions start to prevail. They are dead sailors, dead people. It's hard to remain indifferent. I'm not ashamed to admit that I apologize to them for disturbing their rest.
But the remains of German sailors weren't the only thing that shocked us. The divers found painfully familiar equipment on board the torpedo boat.
Basically, we can assemble a working kit from that.
Let me help.
Just look, the valves are turning. Everything's working.
Hey, it's a manometer. Here's a bypass. And here's an oxygen canister, the only valve.
Well, that's right. It's probably an output. And here's an input. It has spent 76 years underwater, but its valves are still turning.
That's a valve, a gauge, and even a mask.
Divers of the Underwater Research Center took turns to continue submerging time and time again. Time is a very precious resource. It needs to be rationed. The weather conditions in the northwest are already starting to remind us of that. A distinctive feature of this strange spring is that it's totally unpredictable. This year just can't be worse. 2020, stop doing that. That's how the first sea voyage looks in the current TV season. It wasn't only us who came to Neva Island, but 2 meter waves as well, for some reason. As you might understand, our plans change along the way. The only pleasant thing is that it's nature itself that changes them, and we can't do anything about that. The captain of research vessel Akvenacht hides us from the wind behind Neva Island. The rocks prevent us from becoming closer to the shore. The sea is showing us how the Baltic winning strategy was born. You can wonder about the tides of history as many times as you please, but Peter the Great had reviewed the terrain and threatened the Swedes with their huge ships of the line by using just a rowing galley fleet that could better hide between the islands and perform maneuvers along the straits. One can hardly come close to the islands on a huge sailing ship. The same happened in the 20th century, when the Mosquito fleet was used against German torpedo boats. That's what small chasers and torpedo boats were called. The commander of the operation, Sergei Alexandrovich Osipov, has learned all the ropes by 1944 and perfectly understood that even several G5 boats weren't the best rivals against two armed to the teeth torpedo boats. So, Captain 3rd Rank Tihanov, Captain 3rd Rank Ivanov, and Captain Lieutenant Ushov most likely conducted an attack attempt. But pay attention to the way in which a G5 can perform an attack from a distance. Its design specifies that the G5 needs to evade their own launch torpedoes and requires some space ahead for maneuvers, so they can't approach a target up close.
All of our torpedo boats missed.
They couldn't approach their targets to the necessary distance, right?
That's right. They couldn't get close enough. G5 torpedo boats weren't the best in terms of their design. So the Germans went back to the Skerries.
Let's mention the tides of history again. Now the divers miss the torpedo boat. It's just magic. They are very experienced divers. They've seen a lot, but all of them admit that the object is uneasy and can't explain why.
The ship evokes an uneasy feeling. We worked on the ship last year. We installed safety lines and started to get to know the whereabouts of items on the sediment and in the ship. As a result, at the start of our current expedition, we managed to roll stationary ropes that we needed only on the third day. As it turned out later, we missed the ship just by sailing past it. When we looked closer, it turned out that we had sailed right over the ship. It was right below us.
The torpedo boat was defeated using an attrition tactic through a number of attempts. During one submersion, we noticed an item that looked like a rucksack under a gun barrel. I don't know what's inside, and most likely the divers don't know either. We'll have to be careful with it, because the tarpaulin is damaged and can be easily torn off. We'll try to open the rucksack gently. Gently means in water. A sudden change of environment will be fatal for it now. Those who have raised the load from 1944 will do the honors of opening it.
It's a ziplock. It's a Nazi hermetic fastener.
It was fastened like that from both sides.
Some kind of tubes.
It's a first aid kit.
First aid kit, yeah. I can feel something solid.
A chocolate bar?
That's a thing.
It looks like these braces can be bent back to hold it by hand.
As you can see, something's got stuck due to rust. If we jerk it, we'll ruin either the item or the rucksack.
That's definitely some kind of special rucksack. It's either a medicine bag.
Well, it's not a bag for a, let's say...
Not for a usual crew member?
Yes, that's right. I think this is the bag holding life-saving equipment. That's because the things we managed to raise have been packed for individual purposes. The things packed in these tarpaulin packages are either food or medicine. In other words, the rucksack is packed with various items. It's emergency stock to be used in case of shipwreckage or similar catastrophic event.
The German sailors never used the contents of the rucksack. The G5 Mosquitoes forced the Germans to turn back and set a course towards the location where they were supposed to meet the Finnish minesweepers that should have guided T-30 and T-31 through the minefields. The Finnish vessels hadn't arrived at the meeting point. The Germans then decided to return to a secret seaway and retreat along the same route, but it required them to pass close by Neva Island.
They were approaching the island from that direction, from the north. So they posed a threat to the Russian landing troops.
A threat to the landing troops couldn't be tolerated. New participants became embroiled in the battle. Senior Lieutenants Tranienko and Lieutenant Bushoyev and their more advanced D3 boats. Pay attention to the fact that they conduct torpedo attacks in a different way, and they can therefore get in closer to their target. We can't see exactly how the Battle of Neva Island developed, but we can determine some of the events of the battle. Today, we can look dozens of meters underwater and decades into the past. TV viewers can see sunken ships through your eyes because you're recording and showing them to us. What do you notice first when you're underwater?
This question is difficult and easy at the same time. Actually, it's really the on-camera light that has the biggest influence on underwater pictures. I can barely see a thing through the camera. When I get back to the surface, I re-watch the recorded material, and even I'm surprised by the things I've recorded. It may seem to you that you can't see an object due to poor visibility or acuity. In reality, the visibility for a camera and visibility for a diver are completely different. These are totally different pictures.
You say that TV viewers have a better picture than you do underwater. Is that true?
Yes, it may surprise you, but it's definitely true. That's why we divers visit one and the same sector several times, in order to make several recordings. While filming underwater, we also use on-camera light that is quite overwhelming. That's why we draw our routes, mark down the spots where we stop, and some spots to focus on. Due to poor visibility, we can't take master shots here. We have to take close-ups almost everywhere, and have to submerge several times to a single section, taking into account that we can't always even see what we wanted to shoot at that time. You re-watch your recordings on the surface and then dive again.
Now, we've also harnessed the achievements of computer modeling. In previous episodes of Underwater Romance, we restored external views of sailing ships from previous centuries by using old drawings and underwater camera recordings. In this case, we don't even need to invent anything. We just need to combine blueprints, maps, and perform a terrain association.
Let's assume that I guessed right about the atmosphere. Yes, this is it. It's very useful to come here and take a look. We had absolutely specific types of ships, which is why there is no place for fiction here. A layout of the battle also existed, but on the other hand, the battle lasted for almost 2 hours. We couldn't fit 2 hours into a movie. We've changed the total running time of the entire movie. And the result, to my mind, is much more dynamic and intense. But in any case,
compressed in time?
Yes. But on the other hand, thanks to the time compression, the movie received an interesting, I think, emotional tint to it. The Russian torpedo boats attacked the Germans with such ferocity that the latter understood they weren't welcome here.
Any small and revealing things can be useful. Everything will be reflected in a modeled battle. For example, who wouldn't like to see the beginning of the attack from the German perspective? The torpedo boat was equipped with 4 binoculars. These devices are used to determine the range to a target. 3 of them have been found already. 1 pair of binoculars was not from the ship when it got wrecked, and it's being raised to the surface using lift bags. These are underwater parachutes filled with air. The mosquito fleet was too pushy. 2 German torpedo boats turned back and went to the skerries. T-31 was trailing behind, and the Soviet torpedo boats stayed on her tail.
A feature of D-3 torpedo boats was that they were armed with powerful guns and machine guns, 20mm automatic Oerlikon guns, and DSHK heavy machine guns. The Soviet torpedo boats attacked from 2 directions and opened up such fierce fire upon their enemies that the artillery crews manning the rear guns of the German boats were simply annihilated. With nobody firing at you, you can approach closer to your enemies and hit the ship right at its center with your torpedoes from a 100-meter distance, literally.
Can we be sure now that both torpedoes hit the target?
We can, because first of all, the report reads that it was a double explosion. The ship broke into two parts almost immediately. That's a sign of pretty powerful destruction. It's most likely that two torpedoes exploded.
Her colleague T-30, when her crew saw that...
T-30 was ahead of her. They just sped up and retreated to the skerries, without saving their comrades. One Soviet torpedo boat tried to chase them, but missed when they fired at the retreating enemy.
T-30 survived another month out in the Baltic Sea. During the night of August 18, 1944, the ship exploded while laying minefield Seagull 106. 114 German sailors died. The losses of T-31, which was destroyed with torpedoes, compromised 82 crew members dead and 6 taken captive. Around 80 crew members were taken on board by the Finnish sailors, who had finally managed to arrive at the meeting point. Captain Heinrich Peter Perkham was amongst the saved crewmates. He then returned to HQ and continued his service, doing his more familiar business of composing documents.
The captain was, mildly speaking, a staff officer. To put it correctly, he wasn't much of an experienced sea wolf, but he knew how to compose reports in the right manner. That's why the report he composed about the battle, where his ship had been sunk, was very good. He wrote that he had destroyed 8 Soviet boats, including the 2 boats that had sunk his ship. In reality, the Russians suffered no losses. For that, the captain was honored with the German Cross, which was called Fried Eggs by common folk in Germany. That order was used during the war, and it was an unconventional and not particularly honorable order, to put it mildly. Most heroic deeds were not commemorated with that order.
Not a single Baltic sailor from the Soviet torpedo boat crews died in the Battle of Neva Island. However, various other events unfolded here soon after, and surely you can find Soviet ships here at the bottom too. Divers of the Underwater Research Center found minesweeper TSCH-45 in close proximity to the shore, and we found an obelisk in memory of its crew on the shore.
This is a memorial to the sailors of Russian minesweeper TSCH-45. It was destroyed while approaching the island. She delivered supplies for the landing troops, such as weapons, ammunition, etc. Although the Gulf of Finland was recaptured, the Germans sent a submarine flotilla to aid the Finnish. The submarines hunted down any ship they could find. While approaching the island, Russian minesweeper TSCH-45 was hit with a torpedo launched by submarine U-745. The minesweeper still lies there as a true monument with its bow gun oriented forward.
You can find weapons, ammunition, and many human stories like this on board the minesweeper. The Russian sailors tried to make the daily routine of their landing troops on Neva Island better by bringing them gifts.
It's a drink, some kind of liqueur. If you look closely, these are blueberries. All these events happened in August 1944. The island was famous for its blueberry plants. A soldier prepared a tasty vitamin liqueur and sealed it with a cork made of a tightly rolled newspaper. If you take a closer look, you can even distinguish words on it. That's what they carried to their friends on Nerva Island, a place that was just a bunch of rocks lacking not only blueberries, but any grass as well. The ship was destroyed and the bottle remained underwater. It has been underwater for 76 years.
The history of every country consists of such people's stories. Our representations of the events that happened in the middle of the 20th century has to be accurate and not leave any opportunity for doubt and rethinking. Armed people came to the Russian lands where they were fought off and stopped.
This, for example, previously, it was a gun, Walther, PPK. In our country, this model is most famous, I think, from James Bond movies. The movie character had exactly that model. It's an officer's pistol, at least what's left of it. In a lab, after we remove all stains from it, we'll be able to learn how badly the item has corroded and whether it's possible to restore it for display in a museum.
It's an amazing story. You can read everywhere on the internet about it being the greatest victory, but no one really knows anything about it.
That's all. Right.
That's insanely sad.
Yes, that's why we're proud that we have found the T-31. And, yes, Now we want to mark the outcome of our expedition in the following general way. So what? What is hiding within it? What have we found on it? What interesting things did we manage to unveil in terms of the ship's history and objects she had? We want to go on. We want to know what these big words, the greatest victory of surface forces in the Baltic Sea and probably in all theatres of war, mean.
You can see inscriptions scratched into the rocks of Neva Island by sailors from various countries and different centuries even. They sat here on the shore waiting to be rescued, or for an order to make another rush to the nearest islands. We collect crumbs of information from Neva Island about events that are important for us and our generation. We've seen ships that mark our victories, and we've learnt more and more about these victories of our ships.
Remember, the available bonus code can be activated till January 10, 2021, and the missions can be completed until the end of update 0.9.12.